Now that we've introduced the idea of centripetal force, we can now see where it can be applied. Take for example this car moving along a curved road. As it's moving along the curve, it has centripetal force because of its uniform circular motion. So there will be centripetal force towards the centre of this hypothetical circle. But as it's an object with mass, that means it'll also have a force due to gravity, identified as mg. So now you have two forces acting downwards, mg and the centripetal force. But as it's not moving through down into the road, we can assume that there's a force balancing these two out, and this is called the support force, and this is comes from the equal and opposite reaction to these two forces. We must also consider the horizontal component of velocity, because this is what gives the uniform circular motion, with the velocity being perpendicular to the centripetal force, or the acceleration towards the centre. Now that we've constructed this diagram right here, that means that we can now come up with a mathematical equation for the action of the centripetal force in the circle. So, we can find out the vector of these quantities by taking into consideration their direction. As both of these are acting down, the centripetal force and the force of gravity, we can consider them to be positive, and the force acting in the opposite direction, which is the support force, to be negative, just for ease in the equation. So we take this description as mv squared of the centripetal force is equal to mg minus the support force, and this gives the centripetal force from both the magnitude from the gravitational force and the support force, bearing in mind that the velocity is at 90 degrees and therefore has no effect on the vertical components. Now, this can be rearranged to get mv squared over r minus mg is equal to s, or minus s. And this simply refers to what the support force would be if we take these two vectors into consideration. And as the forces have to cancel out, that means this description is correct. However, what you also need to consider is that there will be a speed where mg and mv squared over r are going to be equal, so the centripetal force will equal the force of gravity. Now this has several implications. Take for example this here. If we approach the prerequisite speed of v0, where these two cancel out, that means we'll have no support force. And as we have no support force, mv squared will be equal to mg. And with this in mind, that means we'll have no force acting upwards, and the car will simply fly off the road once it reaches the top, because there's no force from preventing it doing so. And this is a very critical point in the road, and this is why you should never exceed the velocity where the support force is completely cancelled out by the force of gravity and the centripetal force. It should also be added that with this equation right here, it can be rearranged to give gr is equal to v0 squared, which gives the description of when velocity will be equal to the force required to cancel out the support force. Another example of centripetal force in a circle is in a car going around a roundabout. So as you can see, it's moving in a circle, so that means its velocity is moving in the horizontal plane, and this is moving, and the centripetal force is moving towards the centre. And much like you would on the hill example, there is a certain velocity where it will lose contact with the road due to the forces being equal to each other. However, this is caused by something which is called the limiting force of friction, which is the provider of the centripetal force in this particular scenario. And this is given by mu mg. But this isn't really required for the course. All you need to know is that every so often, that if you go above the required velocity, then it'll lose contact with the road. One of the more complicated examples of this would be the action of a car moving along a banked slope at angle theta. Now, it's not the gravity which causes the problem, because this move works directly downwards regardless of the angle that theta is. However, if we take into consideration the support force, seeing as though the road is at a slope, that means that support force must act at an angle of theta to the normal, which is acting upwards. So this means that this can be split and resolved into two quantities, the vertical component and the horizontal component. The horizontal component gives the magnitude of the centripetal force towards the centre, and the vertical component, as again the car is not falling through the centre of the road, means that the vertical component must exactly cancel out the gravitational component. So now, let's resolve these vectors. As I said earlier, you can use basic trigonometry to find out the horizontal and the vertical component. So the vertical component will be sine theta, the support force, or as we have two wheels here, n1 plus n2 is equal to mv squared over r, as this is the horizontal component and therefore the centripetal force acting towards the centre. Also, if we take cos theta, support force, we can find the vertical component, and as we have an equal and opposite force acting along the force of gravity, and because it's not moving through the centre, we can assume that these forces are balanced, and therefore cos theta must be equal to mg. So we can also rearrange this into another equation, and as we know that sine theta over cos theta is equal to tan theta from basic mathematics, we can come up with a new equation. So sine theta divided by cos theta support force is equal to mv squared over mgr. And this arises because we're basically substituting this here and this there to give this new equation. And this can be cancelled down quite easily to give tan theta is equal to v squared over gr. And from this, we can find the force, the minimum force, where there'd be no sideways friction if speed v. So basically, when the forces cancel out. Now, as this is acting on a slope, and due to the vertical, this not being a directly horizontal component or a direct vertical component, we can see that we need a much larger speed than we would need on a normal circular linear road. The minimum velocity, where v squared gr is equal to tan theta, is basically the speed wherein you would find that there would be no sideways friction and therefore the car would slip off the road. This is just a little addition to what I said earlier.